Hello everyone, welcome to the Geo Ecologist. I'm Dr. Krishnanand and you have been watching my series on oceanography. So in this session on oceanography, we are going to learn about the details of ocean deposits or marine sediments. What are the factors that contribute to it and what are the important terminologies associated with the marine sediments. So before we go ahead, don't forget to subscribe to our channel and do share the videos with others as well. So now, after we have already understood about the movement of ocean waters, that is in the form of waves, tides and ocean currents in the last lecture, now let's understand about the depositional features, about the ocean deposits. So what you see here is that unconsolidated material, it means they are loose material which are derived from what? From various sources and are deposited where? At the ocean floors and also on the shelf and slope of the oceans, right? And these are called what? The marine sediments or the ocean deposits. So basically what? They include weathered and eroded particles of rocks, fragments of dirt, dust, volcanic ashes, remains of marine organisms and fragments of meteorites. So these are the larger material that are part of these unconsolidated material that we say as ocean deposits. Now one important point that we need to consider here is that these sediments or these ocean deposits are derived from the process of weathering and erosion that we have already discussed in geomorphology. So if you have not watched the video on weathering and erosion, you can go to the playlist in geomorphology and you can watch it there. So the process is the denudational process, which is common, of what? Of the continental rocks that are transported to the ocean by various agents. One of them is river, the other is wind, right? So these are important agents which are responsible for these material that are deposited in the ocean. Now, besides the decaying and decomposition of the marine organisms, remember the flora and fauna decays, that is both plants and animals, they also contribute to the ocean deposits. That's one of the most important points to remember here. Now, if you look into this image, now this is the most recent part of the entire ocean topography if you see. So this is about 10 to 100 years old. Then if you go furthermore, you find that gradually the years are increasing, right? So further, if you see this portion, you have about 1000 years old and then further 1000 to 1 lakh years old. So as you go down the ocean, the age of the ocean increases. So what is the probability that with age more depositions are liable or likely to occur where? At the ocean bottom, right? So surface will have lesser deposits and those deposits will be newer in terms of age. And as you go down the ocean, you'll find the older sediments or older deposits. That's one important point here. Now, beside these broken parts of the sunken ships and boats are also there. Remember, during the age of discovery, since then, last 600 years, we have been traversing all around the world in oceans. And many times there are many ships that have sunk, many boats that have sunk. So their material is also there, part of the same unconsolidated material, and that is because of the human actions also. So those are also part of the ocean deposits. So the ocean floors are repository of sediments of various sorts and different time periods and act as what? The library of Earth's geological history. Now remember, because of this time period, as we say, right from 10 to 100 years to thousands of years, it is a repository. It is the rich archive of all that geological history of the Earth, right? So if you want to understand the Earth's geological history, oceans are one of the best sources to study, right? And apart from them, there is another terminology that is associated here, this phrase, marine snowfall. Remember, snowfall happens on the Earth's surface, but when the settling of these marine sediments is there on the ocean floor, that phenomena is also known as marine snowfall. So remember this new word or phrase that you may have come across, that is marine snowfall. And marine snowfall is not about the snowfall that happens on the surface, rather it is about these depositions which are gradually settled a layer after layer on the ocean's surface. Now let's elaborate further more. So furthermore, we must understand the zonations that is there in the ocean, right? So if you observe this image, you can find several zones are there, right? So first few words are there which needs to be understood in clearly manner. So neritic is one part. What is this neritic? It is basically coming from Greek neritis, which means near. So it means this particular zone which is near to the continental surface, right? This shore area, this area which is shallow water zone, part of the photic zone, remember, where light penetrates through. So this is near the shore, that's why it is called neritic zone, right? And then away from neritic zone, you have oceanic zone,
right? That is important to remember here. And remember, it is away from the near land. It is away, that's why it is called high sea or open sea, and also refers to as pelagic zone. So this pelagic zone, if you see, is the oceanic open zone. So neritic zone, and then away is the pelagic zone. That is important to remember. Then you have something which is called benthic zone, and benthic is coined by, remember, the ecologist, the Haeckel, and Greek word is benthos, basically meaning depth of the sea. So as you go down this photic zone, as you go to this aphotic zone, where light does not go through, where light doesn't penetrate, that zone is called the benthic zone, right? It goes deep inside the ocean, right? So this is about the benthic. So these are the terminologies that we must understand: neritic, pelagic, benthic, right? Photic, aphotic. All these words are very much important. And then the base already we know is this abyssal zone, that is the base, right? Apart from this, there are certain more zonations that we must understand. This is pelagic zone. So what is the upper part? It is called epipelagic. Up to 100 meters. Remember, epi word, epidermis, the upper surface. So this is called epipelagic, means the upper part of pelagic zone. Then you have something which is between 100 to 1000 meters. This is called mesopelagic. So in between something is there. That is why it is meso. Remember, epi, meso. And then what we have is the bathypelagic. Between 1000 meters to 4000 meters, this is part of the bathypelagic, that is the third layer in the pelagic zone. And further, if you go down to the surface, you have abyssopelagic, which is on the abyssal plains, right? Where you have these black smokers also, which are the smokes released from the degassing of ocean surface. And then finally, you have the Haeckel zone, which is part of these deep sea trenches, which is beneath the ocean abyss, right? Beneath the ocean floor. That is where in the deep sea trenches you find this Haeckel zone. And remember, Hades, the Greek god of underworld, that is important to remember here. That's how the name is Hades, and Haeckel zone is coming here. So these are the zonations of the oceans in terms of its depth, in terms of its nearness to the coast, in terms of its away from the coast, right? So these are certain zonations and certain terminologies that we must understand when we are talking about ocean deposits. So accordingly, the deposits made at these particular places are known by the same name. So you have benthic deposits, you have neritic deposits, you have pelagic deposits, right? Right? You have abyssal deposits. So these are important in terms of the depositions of these unconsolidated sediments that we say ocean deposits. Now, the study of these marine deposits is geologically, biologically, and culturally, apart from climatologically. Remember these four words, 2, 3, and 4. What are these four words, four components? Geological, biological, cultural, and climatological. So ocean deposits or marine deposits have four kinds of significance. They are geologically significant, they are biologically significant, they have cultural values as well, and also climatologically significant, as we have already understood in the entire climatology lecture series. Right? So there are certain points that you can read here on this screen. You can pause the video here, that how it is very significant, how it helps us, or it provides information, right? How does this ocean deposit help us to know more about the oceans, about the Earth's history, right? So the first point, if you see, it is saying that it gives us clues about tectonic history of Earth and plate movements. Then it is talking about the reconstruction of paleoclimate, that is the old climate, the ancient climate, right? In this geological time scale, right? Then understanding the flow pattern of ocean water, mainly through ocean currents. Then about the marine organisms that are there, right? Their evolutionary history. Then impacts of the meteorites through the historical time period, where we see the composition of these marine sediments. Then we also understand about the nature of undersea volcanic eruptions also. So you have volcanoes inside the sea and their eruptions also happen, right? Then seafloor spreading, the very famous part where, you know, continental drift and plate tectonics are linked. Then also about the paleomagnetism. So paleomagnetism and paleoclimate, all these things are about the reconstruction of Earth's geological history, right? And also about its magnetic history. And similarly, nutrient supply to marine organisms, occurrence of mass extinction, reconstruction of sea level and climatic changes, and cultural heritage from the sunken ships and boats. That is how all these points are relevant in terms of why do we need to study these marine deposits or marine sediments for that matter, because these are repository of such vast amount of knowledge that is important for all of us. The next important thing is the three main mechanisms of the production of marine sediments. It means, how are these marine sediments produced? three main mechanisms are weathering, erosion, and the decay of shells. So remember, these first two are already discussed, and the decay of shells is when the animals and the plants, their shells and their bodies decay, right? That is how they contribute to the formation of these marine sediments. Now, if you observe this data, the average annual surface runoff of 40,000 kilometers square from continents to the oceans through river transports about 15,000 million to 20,000 million tons of sediments per year. Now, remember, the river itself is the biggest contributor of sediments. That is about almost 20,000 million tons of sediments per year to the oceans, and besides 4,000 million tons of soluble material in suspension, which is already there hanging in the ocean water. So that is important to remember according to this 1963 study of Eiksundborg, right? Then glaciers in high latitudes also contribute, as remember, glacial erosion happens in higher latitudes, right? Close to the polar areas in Arctic and Antarctic belts, right? They also contribute to the sediments. Then wind-blown sands and dust from the coastal lands also provide the ocean sediments. Then decay and decomposition of the skeletals of dead marine organisms. And remember, we are going to learn about corals in details, right, in the lectures to come. So that will also be part of this skeletal or dead marine organisms. And then the erosion of coastal rocks by marine waves, tidal storms and storm surges that we study. That is also contributory to this sediment production, right? That is where all these marine sediments or all these marine deposits are created. The next important thing related to it is that humans' impact on marine sedimentation. What is this human's role, or what is this human's factor that is important here? And remember, human role is what is going to be asked in certain examination as questions, right? So humans' impact on marine sedimentation is one of the most important aspects when we are talking about the process of creation of these sediments. So dredging, that is basically what? Digging or scouring of the ports and harbors. Remember, that is what we do as an activity, human activity, to improve what? To improve navigation channels and modification and of what? The shapes and patterns of the waves and currents accordingly. So this is where we are concerned as human beings. We change it, we tame it, right? That is where it is important. So materials derived from the dredging are generally dumped at many alternative locations also. When you dig something, we take out something, so that material you have to also dump at certain places. So when you dump at certain places, you make alternative locations for it, and that contributes to these offshore locations, shallow areas of the adjacent to the harbor, onshore areas to reclaim the land, to enrich them, and that is where they also contribute to the marine sedimentation. If you keep digging material from one place and transporting it to the other, automatically, remember, it's going to change the course of the waves and currents. That is first point. And also, the material that we take out and we deposit somewhere else, it's going to contribute to the marine sedimentation. That's why it is important. So sometimes seafloor is also dredged, remember, to obtain the materials to reclaim marshy coastal land especially, or to replenish the erosion beaches. So that is also important here, that we also tame these sea floors. We take out material from there to reclaim certain areas, replenish certain areas, right? That is why this human activity is important, and this activity deepens the sea floor as well. So now, if you take an example, Government of India also launched a massive project called Setu Samudram in 2005. For what? For dredging the shallow portion of sea. And where it was located, remember? Between Tamil Nadu coast and the Bay of Bengal and Gulf of Mannar through Pak Strait. So that is that particular area where you have the Setu Samudram project, right? And because it had religious objections, that is why it was stopped, but it was also based on this dredging factor only. So basically, removal of the sediments will entirely change the course of the flow of waves, also the currents, and also it will bring a change to the marine life. Right? So that is also important, and that's where human factors are important. Apart from this, you see this flow diagram that factors for marine sedimentation. This you can draw in your answers when you're writing. That is quantity, that is density of marine sediments. That is one factor where there is a change. Then size and shape of particles also matter. And then energy condition of currents at the site of deposition also matters. So these are certain things that are important in terms of factor of marine sedimentation as well. Now, let's talk about the deposits itself. what are their size. So this is a size based classification of the marine sediments, and we have already talked also while discussing the soil, right? So what is there? Boulder, cobble, pebble, granules, sand, silt and clay. And if you observe right from boulder to this clay, what is happening? If you see, the diameter here is decreasing order, right? So smallest diameter is clay and biggest is this boulder, right? So this is boulder, cobble, pebble, granule, sand, silt, clay, right? So you have B, C, P, G, S, S, C, right? So S, S, C, you can remember, staff selection exam, right? S, S, C. And what you have is B, C, P, and G. So P, G is one thing and B, C is one thing. So B, C, P, G, S, S, C. That is how you can remember in decreasing order of the diameter size, right? In terms of the mnemonics that we make, right? So mnemonics are basically for the easy memory, right? If you can remember it, BC, PG and SSC, right? Now let's move further more. Now if you look into these data sets, what you see in this table, you have classification of marine sediments by source of origin of particles, right? So according to the sediment type, you have terrigenous, biogenous, hydrogenous and cosmogenous, right? And their sources are given, examples are given, distribution is given and their percentage in overall ocean is given, right? So this is one type of data set that you can pause the video and note down for yourself, right? Then what you see, there is a flow diagram which can be used for a good innovative answer as well. You see the physical weathering from volcanic sources, existing rocks, cosmogen through chemical weathering and through transportation by water, ice and winds. And remember, solution process and deposition process, that is precipitation and deposition, you generate chemical, biogenous, terrigenous, pyroclast, cosmogen, all these sediments, right? So these are the important data sets that can be utilized for your answer. So if you want to note it down, you can pause the video here and you can note it down and then you can move further more. Now if you see this image, it is where you have continental shelf, then you have slope, then you have the plains, right? And how different kinds of materials are found at different levels. So terrigenous, the word itself is terra, this is close to land. Then you have biogenous, that is away in the abyssal plains. Then you have hydrogenous, volcanic eruptions happening, right? So remember, this is mid-oceanic ridges where you have these volcanic ashes and other materials, lava depositions happening. So this is how different zonations of these different kinds of sediments are also marked. Now if we observe it carefully, the classification of marine sediments is largely into these five types. So first is called the terrigenous sediments, right? The word itself is terra. So fine coarse grains that are produced by weathering and erosion of the rocks of land, typically sand and mud, right? Then you have biogenous sediments, which are, the word itself suggests, it is biotic in nature. It has the organisms, their shells, their skeletal debris, right? Calcium carbonate and mud silicates are there. Then you have the third one, that is hydrogenous. It's also called the euthygenic sediments. Now remember, A is silent here, so it's called euthygenic, right? So euthygenic sediments are what? These are the particles that are precipitated by chemical or biochemical reactions in the seawater on the sea floor itself. It is not coming from anywhere outside. Rather, it is coming from a localized source. It is being produced at the sea surface itself. That is important here, and it has many manganese and phosphate nodules. Then what we have is the volcanogenic sediments. So remember, material coming from volcanoes, that is where inside the ocean you have also volcanoes, right? And then you have something which is cosmogenic, coming from the cosmos, from the outer space, right? So these materials are basically the material that is coming from the outer space in terms of the meteorites, right? Now elaborating it further more in details, the terrigenous, which is also called lithogenic marine sediments, right? It has continental lithogenous sediments, submarine volcanic lithogenous sediments, and the examples are here. You see gravel, sand, silt, clay, mud, which has also blue mud, green mud, red mud, different colors, right? Then biogenous marine sediments, neritic. So remember, near the surface, right? Neritic and pelagic sediments. So what is there? Remember, it is biotic material, calcareous remains. So calcareous ooze, petropod ooze, globigerina ooze, siliceous ooze, then you have radiolaria ooze, then you have diatom ooze. It all depends upon which organism is there and whose concentrate or whose deposition is there. So ooze are what? Ooze are basically the remains of these dead animals, right? So ooze is basically like a mud deposition on the ocean floor only, right? So that is biogenous marine sediments. Then you have hydrogenous marine sediments, as we talked, that is also called euthygenic sediments. So manganese nodules, phosphate nodules, oolites, which is basically calcium carbonate or limestone particles. Then you have metal sulfides, gypsum, halite, other salts, right? Then in cosmogenic marine sediments, space dust, meteor particles, iron nickel meteorites, silicate chondrites, All these are the component of the cosmogenic marine sediment example. Then in volcanogenic marine sediments, you have volcanic dust and volcanic ashes. So this is for the example that you should remember when you're writing your answer, the different types or different classification of these marine sediments, right? Then further, if you look at the world distribution, this map is important because it is talking about the river input. Remember, we talked about river input, which is supposed to be the maximum contributor to the ocean deposits. So if you observe here, this portion, right, this eastern portion of this Asia and Southeast Asia, you have maximum. Then what you have is the northern portion of the South America, which is part of Amazon River. And then you have some part of Yukon River, that is the northwestern part of the Alaska, and certain areas in Africa, right, and certain area in Mediterranean. These are the major contributors of the sediments through rivers to the oceans in the world, right? So this map is one map which can be drawn while you're answering a question where you're talking about the input of a river or silt to the oceans through rivers. That is important. And then you have these biogenous sediments and hydrogenous sediment contribution and their examples, which we have already discussed in detail. So that is important to remember here. Now come to the scientific classification by different scientists. The ocean deposits are classified on different bases. One is on the basis of location. So the name of the scientist is again Murray. Remember, Murray and Jenkin classification is the most famous classification. So Murray classified these deposits into these colors, that is blue, yellow, gray, or red mud, right? So terrigenous deposits and pelagic deposits. Terrigenous are basically the land surface nearby, so terra word, right? Found mainly on the continental shelves. And pelagic location is basically the deep ocean floor. So remember the examples from both of them according to this Murray's classification, that is blue mud, red mud, green mud, coral mud, volcanic mud, gravel, sand, right? That is part of all the land area, that is shelf area. And then in deep ocean, you have all these ooze and clay, right? That is the pelagic deposits. So red clay, radiolaria ooze, diatom ooze, globigerina, petropod ooze, all these are examples, right? So remember Murray's classification into two types, that is terrigenous deposits and pelagic deposits. Now let's talk about the other classification by Jenkins, that is on the basis of depth. So the earlier was on the basis of location. Now this is on the basis of depth. So remember deep sea deposits, then you have the shallow sea deposit, which is part of meritic, and then you have littoral deposit between high and low tide water. So you have three types in terms of Jenkins classification. So deep sea, remember, in terms of pelagic and terrigenous. So red clay, radiolaria, diatom, and then globigerina and petropod, part of pelagic, the same. Then terrigenous, you have all the muds. Then neritic or shallow sea deposit, basically up to 100 fathoms, that is gravel, sand, and mud. Remember, 1 fathom is about just less than 2 meters, right? And then you have littoral deposits between the high tide and low tide. Again, it is gravel, sand, and mud. So this is one classification that was given by Jenkins. So remember, Murray and Jenkins on the basis of location and depth classification. And then finally, the third one is on the basis of origin of these sediments, right? Where they originate. So one is littoral deposits. Remember, the word itself is littoral. It is lit. So it is derived from the land where you have these deposits, where you have shallow water zone, where you have light penetrating. So you have shore deposits and shelf deposit, right? That is part of littoral deposit. Then you see hemipelagic deposits, partly from land and partly from marine, right? So that is in the second zone where you have more of sea coming in and also land there, right? So green mud, volcanic mud, coral mud, all these are part of this continental slope, that is in the next level. Then you have eupelagic deposits, right, of marine and cosmic origin. So you're coming down further here, ocean deep, you have marine sediments as well as cosmogenic sediments, right? So these are the three important classification or three important types on the basis of origin of sediments. And examples of eupelagic deposits are red clay, radiolaria ooze, globigerina, petropod. So largely examples are same. It's just the way of looking at these sediments and their ways of classification. So you have to answer in the way question is asked. If it is asked on the basis of its location or depth or all of them or only origin, accordingly you can answer. And you can also make a particular diagram like this to actually elaborate your answer with particular labeling of diagram. And at last, there is something called sediment succession that is also important, that what is the succession of the deposition of various sediments. So if you observe this particular diagram, what you see, there is a seafloor spreading and material is coming out from this particular vent, right? This is like a mid-oceanic ridge, right? So from here the material is going both the sides. So in the beginning you have thin sediment, then what you have is biogenic forum ooze, then you have pelagic, that is as going down the abyssal plane, and then you have CCD, right? It's not cafe coffee day, remember my words. It's CCD, basically means carbonate compensation depth. So these are the areas where you have carbonate compensation, or basically it is defined as that water depth at which the rate of supply of this calcium carbonate from the surface is equal to the rate of their dissolution, because they are also dissolving at a certain rate in the ocean water. So that is particular area where these are being dissolved, and there is a balance, right? So what you have, this thin sediment, biogenic, and then you have pelagic, and then you have CCD, right? So this is how there is a succession right from this axis, right? So this is the main axis, and from there you have a succession. So if you want to draw this, you can pause the video and you can draw this. If there is a question on sediment succession related to ocean deposits, you can write it with this particular diagram.
So now, when we have learned about the ocean deposits in details, in the sessions to come, we'll be talking more on coral reefs, their formation, and also about coral bleaching. So stay tuned, stay safe, keep watching.